it is a great privilege to be alive today. It's a great privilege to be in the presence of God worshiping. I'd like you to know that many started this year with us. Some lasted till January, ending. Some continued till February, and ended everything in February. But here you are, God made it possible that you are not only able to go through January, February, March, April, May, June, July, and here we are in August. We are trusting God that even beyond the August, the Lord will keep you. I'd like us to just praise God and sing a song to Him.
Lord, we pray that all struggles in our lives,
will be over in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
As we register our presence in the court of heaven, we pray, Lord, that you will attend unto us in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
Thank you, faithful Father.
Amen.
Lord, we bless your holy name.
Hallelujah.
In Jesus' name, we have prayed.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Shake the hand of somebody and say, God bless you. You're welcome. It is a great pleasure to be here today, and I want to thank God for this great opportunity that I have. For me, it is not a right. It is just that God gave me the privilege to be here amongst you. And I wouldn't know whether I would qualify to stand before you to even share the word of God today. I wouldn't know. But I'm trusting that God will use me and then will be able to just speak a word. Because all I ask God this morning is that, Lord, if nothing, just your word, one word for these people. And my prayer is that God will answer that prayer in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
Again, I want to thank the pastor, the wife, the ministers, and the entire zone for having me this weekend. The Lord of heaven will continue to bless you in Jesus' name.
Amen.
As you have heard, Pastor Shalewa is my boss. He handed over to me when I was back in Africa. And he's such a wonderful man of God. I normally tell people, if you are still standing in the Lord, 1 year, 5 years, 10 years, 15 years, 20 years, 25 years after you give your life to Christ, you should be thankful to God. Because if you look at the plan of the enemy, it's such that you will not even last the next day. The Bible says that the devil, which is Satan, he said, he cometh not but to steal, to kill, and to destroy. But he will not find you to kill.
Amen.
Not find you to destroy.
Amen.
In the mighty name of Jesus.
Amen.
The hand of the Lord will continue to keep you.
Amen.
And the Lord will cause you to reign with him in eternity in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
This weekend we'll be looking at the theme. And that theme is, who can remind us, you know you are here. What was the theme? That I will know him. That I will know him. That I may know him. And the first day, which was Friday, we looked at, do you actually know him? If you know him, does he know you? It's one thing for you to claim you know God. But it's another thing for God to say, well, you are mine. In the second day, we were looking at seeking the Lord. And there is no way you know God without seeking him. If you take time enough to seek the Lord, find that many of the things we think they are problems, they will no longer be problems. But just like we said yesterday, many of us do not have the time. You know, we are so busy that we find it even difficult to spare some time to seek the face of the Lord, the bishop of our soul, the one who can do and undo, the one who can kill, the one who can make alive, the one that can, that has the solution and the final say to everything that happens to us. And so this meeting started on Friday just with that thing. And the greatest thing in life, as we stated, is that knowing Christ is the only and the best thing that can ever happen to a man. Because the Bible says we should call his name Jesus. Because he will do what? He will save his people from their sins. If there is anything that is the problem between man and God, it's nothing but the problem of sin. And the solution to that problem is Jesus. And if you have that Jesus, then you have everything. That's why the Bible says, seek ye first the kingdom of God. And say, every other thing shall be added. My prayer is that every other thing will be added unto you in Jesus' name.
Amen.
And the Bible says that if a man have learned to boast, he should not boast in any other thing. He shouldn't boast that, yes, I have a tie, I have a car, or I have a house, or I have chains of degrees, or I have children. The Bible says in Jeremiah 9, chapter 9, verse 23, that if you must boast, then you must boast in this, that you do what? That you know. You do what? You know God. My prayer is that that will be your boasting in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
We went ahead, because I'm only trying to do a recap, just a little recap for those of us who are not around, that many of us are operating under installed capacity. As a believer, you are meant to operate at a particular realm, which is the spiritual realm. But when you do not know God sufficiently, or you do not find time to seek Him, you will always do what? Operate below what? Installed capacity. What God expects you to accomplish within 1 month, you may end up accomplishing that thing in 10 years. Because you have not found time to ask for a blueprint. And just like I said, there is blueprint for everything. I mean, most of us who have iPad or iPhone or Samsung, you know, when it comes, it doesn't just come like that. Except if you buy it well. Talk to me. eBay or what? Amazon. They may not send the what? The instruction paper. But if actually it is new, what comes? There is a blueprint on how to do what? How to operate it. And let me tell you the truth. Your life has a blueprint. You are not just anybody. Maybe you don't understand what I'm saying. That is why you can't get into the US just anyhow. Somebody cannot choose your name and say, look, my name is Impeachy. And come in as what? Doris. Why? Because by the time they get the fingerprint, they know that the two are what? Are different. Even if you were born of the same father or the same mother, what happened? The fingerprints are what?
Different.
And that is to tell you that you are unique. And when God made you, He never made a mistake. And I want you to know that God is relying on you to actually do what He has created you to do. Many of us think that the only reason why we are here is to make money and to get the dollars and just enjoy. It is far, far, far more than that. There is so much that God is expecting from me, that is expecting from you. Because all those things, they are addition. And God is saying, no, there is a specific thing I want this man, this woman to accomplish for me. There is a specific thing I want this family to accomplish for me in America. And until you go to Him and ask, you may not know. You may just live your life day in, day out, without even caring. And may I let you know that there are destinies that have been tied unto you. That if you prosper, those destinies, I'm talking about human beings, you prosper. If you refuse to prosper, those people will die in their poverty, you will die in Christless. There are people God has ordained that you will reach during your lifetime with the gospel. But until you rise up and wake up to your responsibility, those people will always what? Yeah. And that's one thing I want you to realize, that you are not just here by mistake, you are here because God. But you may say, well, I'm not a pastor, I'm not a minister. Yes, you don't have to be for God to use you. Read the Bible from Genesis to Revelation. But the people that God even used most, there are not people that already have appellation, like Pope, the very reverend, the most reverend, or whatever name you want to call them. No. They are ordinary people like you and me. But the only thing is that they have found time to seek the face of the Lord, to discover what God wants for them. My prayer is that we will discover that this morning in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Brethren, what am I saying? That you carry more potential that you presently realize. There is something God has invested in you.
And except you wait on God to ask God, what exactly have you invested in me that you want me to exhibit? You may not be able to do it. Genuine knowledge of God will always bring transformation. All these were things we said Friday, Saturday. And because the text that we read was in Philippians chapter 3, we looked at the desire of Apostle Paul. We said Apostle Paul, his desire was to know the Lord Jesus Christ, to know the power of his resurrection, and to know the fellowship of his sufferings. We said this was a man that wasn't just asking that because he was an unbeliever. He was already what? A believer. He had had an encounter with the Lord Jesus. And yet, the desire, the passion of his soul is that God, if there is anything that I think I need, is to do what? Is to know you. And you may sit there and say, well, what is there of God to know? I know everything of God. It's a lie. You don't. God only reveals a little bit of himself to you at a particular point in time. And the little that he has even released to you, you are not even wrong with it. So it is a process, and it is something that you must desire continuously. It's not something you desire once and then that is the end. We must desire to want to know God. Most of the time, I realize that when we make that desire, the enemy does not allow us to fulfill that desire. But we must of ourselves have this thirst. We must have this hunger after him. That we can only touch God. And these are some of the points we made. We can only touch God by seeking him with all our hearts. And there were three things we mentioned that hinder us from seeking, from touching, from knowing the Lord. Number one, we said we have this self-sufficiency that, well, what is there again for me to learn? And one thing we realize is that the only room that exists is the room for change. And change comes for people who are learners, people who are teachable, people who want to know. You find that when you get to the point where you feel, I know everything, that is just nothing. Even if you're a professor, at least I was a little bit in the academia, and I know what it means. When they call you a professor, it doesn't mean you know everything. What do you know? It's just one little part of that subject, and you go in detail into it, and people say, oh, he's a professor. But when we see them, they say, ah, when you call somebody a professor, it means what? He has read all the books. It's a lie. Ask him about a particular book, he may tell you if he wants to be truthful. I've not even heard about this one. So what we're saying is that, brethren, we must not get to the point where we become self-sufficient. And the second thing we said that does not allow us to see the face of the Lord is distractions created by friends, created by technological devices that we have, created by things that shouldn't even take our time. And yesterday we said so much about that because we have a lot to say today. I won't be able to go into that. And finally we said, one of the other things that makes it impossible for us to truly and truly seek the face of God is that we have other substitutes rather than God. Other substitutes. And finally, we discussed how to seek God and the reward for seeking God. Those are things we discussed. But today, by God's grace, we shall be looking at the people who know their God. Talk to your neighbor, say, the people who know their God.
The people who know their God.
And if you are one of those people who know their God, shout hallelujah.
Hallelujah!
Thank God that you know the Lord. Please open your Bible with me as we take our text from this service, from Daniel chapter 11. Daniel chapter 11.
And I'm going to be very brief because I know some of us will still be going to work. Daniel chapter 11. If your name is Daniel, shout a big hallelujah. So nobody is Daniel here. It means we need to give birth to more children and name them what? Daniel is a good name, isn't it? Daniel is a good name. Daniel chapter 11, verse 32. And it says, Daniel 11, 32. It says, and such as do wickedly against the covenant shall he corrupt by flatteries. But the people that do know their God shall be strong and shall do exploit. As I was preparing for this message, I kept asking God, what is the word for the people? And God kept telling me, he wants to do exploit with your life. I said, God wants to do exploit with your life. He wants to change the world around you through your life. He wants to do something tangible that when long after we are gone, the world will continue to refer to it in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
You see, the God we serve is an investor, and he's a wise investor. He does not just pour himself or pour his life into people's being, except he knows that there is something that he wants to do. America, for example, is fighting war all over the place. You may think it's because they just want to be policemen. No. There are some intrinsic healing agenda. You see them go to Iraq, go to all those places. It's the oil there that they want. If you see them go to a particular country, maybe it has diamond, maybe it has gold. They don't just appear. There are some places where they don't, you don't see them. Let them kill themselves. It makes no difference to them. But they know that, look, by the time we go there, what is inside the place for us? When God decides to create you, he has something in mind. He said, let us make man what? In our own image. Do you believe that you are in the image of God? Do you believe that? Well, whether you don't believe, I believe that for you. But this fellow I'm seeing is not a monkey. He's in the image of who? Of the Lord. But one thing I want you to know that today, God wants to do what? He wants to do exploit with your life. Turn with me to Mark chapter 15. You may say, what kind of that the Lord wants to do? Mark is in the New Testament. Mark chapter 15, I read verses 16 and 17. This is what God is expecting to do through me, through you. Are we there? Mark chapter 15, 16. Oh, or Mark 16, sorry. 15. Let me see. Mark 16, 17. Let me just read 17. And these signs shall do what? Mark 16, 17. And this sign shall do what? That believe in my name shall they cast out devils. They shall speak with new tongues. They shall take up serpents, and if they drink any deadly thing, it shall not hurt them. They shall lay hands on the sick, and they shall do what? Do you believe this is doable? Do you believe it is doable? See, many of us are not even sure. You know why we are not sure? Because we have not created time enough to go into where we need to receive the power to do what? To do those things. And that's why somebody is sick, he would rather go to the ear than come where? That come to the church. Whereas, coming to the church should be able to do what? Take care of the problem instead of going to work. Yeah. Because of the word of God. Except we don't believe the word of God. But what the Lord is saying is that you have the capacity, I have the capacity to do what?
to do all these things. That's why the Bible says in Acts chapter 8, verse 1. Acts chapter 1, verse 8, rather. Acts 1, verse 8. What does it say? And you shall do what? The power is for what? It's for all these things we have talked about. You shall receive power after that the Holy Spirit is come upon you, and you will be my witnesses. What does it mean to be a witness? It means to share with other people what God has done in your life, to share the faith of our Lord Jesus Christ. You shall be my witnesses unto me, both where? Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, and unto the uttermost part of the earth. May this be your goal in life in Jesus' name.
Amen.
When you do that, then these signs shall do what? They shall follow. Now, to achieve the best, because we want to go into the message proper, this is just around it. To achieve the best in life, you cannot afford to be just like any other person. If you have been in place of work in America, they normally tell you we have the worker of the month, isn't it? They say that is the worker of who? The year, isn't it? In some schools, they have the teacher of what? Of the month, and they have the teacher of what? The year. Now, when you look at the things that you see in the life of these people, you find that they go beyond what? They go beyond what? The accepted norm. It's not just doing your work. You go beyond doing the work, and that's why you distinguish yourself, isn't it? Now, in life, God does not expect you just to blend just with every other person, because there is a purpose for which you are existing. So to achieve the best and to accomplish God's purpose for your life or my life, you cannot afford to be like just every other person. When we look at people like that did Apple, or Bill Gates, or all these people, maybe celebrities or people who run like so you know them now. Now you find that these people, they are not just ordinary. They go beyond what the ordinary will do, which is what God is expecting me and you to do. And that is why the Bible says, those that know their God shall do what? Exploit. You have to be strong and do what? Exploit. And that you will do in Jesus' name.
Yeah.
You can't afford to maintain the status quo. You must get positive and be optimistic. And you cannot do all these things except you know who God is. You can't do it except you have found time to seek the Lord in private, so that he can teach you and tell you what to do. Many of us who have spent so much money in going to school, doing other courses, some of us were lawyers back home, today we are nurses, some of us were architects back home, but today we are, you know, think of it. They said you have to retrain yourself, isn't it? But in doing so, you spent a lot. Not only in terms of money, but in terms of what? The effort that you put in. May I let you know that the same effort that you put in doing that, if you put it in knowing who your maker is, you will be a better person. You will be a better person. I will be a better person. It's just like people who want to get married. We are thinking and we are hoping that this marriage will last for how long? Forever. Isn't it? But in doing that, what are the foundations that we have put? How much have we learned and read about marriage? No. We don't go to the library and say, yes, because I'm in this institution, I'm married to my husband, I want to read on how to please this man, to make sure that in this home, there will never be what? Any quarrel. Do we do that? No. We just assume that was slow then. But when you go to the medical school, you didn't assume that it was slow. Is that not true? You assume that you must learn, you must read. So why do you now think that seeking God and getting the best from God will not make you to devote more time in seeking His best? And that is my prayer for you, that you will create time for God. Many of us are too busy for Him. And that is the truth. We are just too busy for God. Many things God wants to do in my life, many things He wants to do in your life. The hymn that we sang said, if only we will allow Him, and the God we serve does not impose Himself. Many of us think that we serve a God that said, yes, because I must do this thing in your life, you must do it. He doesn't. If I come willingly, if I allow Him, what happens? He will do what He wants to do. But if I do not give Him the opportunity, what does He do? He leaves. The Holy Spirit is a spirit of glory. I mean, it's a symbol, it has a symbol of glory, isn't it? In other words, it has very quiet and very, He talks to you, for example, speaks to you that, look, in your place of work, why don't you preach Christ to that lady that you cherish all the time? That woman that whenever you want to buy something, you need to go to her store. You know, little thing that the Holy Spirit will ask you to do. But you know what he said? We immediately dispense it, isn't it? Just say, no, it cannot be now, because there are so many other things for me to do. In the Sunday school, I had somebody who was sharing. Of course, she had some differences with somebody. And the Lord said, look, just go and make her. She came 2 days later, and this same fellow was dead. Now, what if the necessary thing has not been done? May that fellow will go dead, and you will not be happy because you feel there was still something. What we are saying is that when God asks you to do something, the best thing to do is to do what? Do it immediately. And that is why we are here. That God will empower us to do and carry out His counsel in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
I'm here to only let you know that you can overcome every challenge that confronts your life. Your value, your worth in life is a function of the God that is inside of you. Your life is not defined by your name or by the academic or chains of degrees that you have. No. It is defined by what you do, what you carry. I saw us today when we were in the Sunday school and we were talking about anger. Of course, if you choose to carry anger all over the place, what will you express? You will express anger everywhere. But if you have one way or the other, through the study of the Word of God and through the help of God, know that there is only one thing that can kill anger, and that is what? Who knows it? The fruit of the Spirit. Period. Galatians chapter 5. Go to Galatians chapter 5. It's there. 22. Once you have the fruit of the Spirit, even when somebody is coming with anger, how do you respond? Because the man that is coming to me is dead. The Lord will help us in Jesus' name.
Yeah.
I said the Lord is going to help me in Jesus' name.
Yeah.
So what does it mean when we say Daniel 11:32 that those that know their God shall be what? Shall be strong and they shall do exploit. It means you will do exploit.
Yeah.
I said you will do exploit.
Yeah.
You won't understand this until you read Daniel chapter 1, verses 1 to 8. Can we read it together? Daniel chapter 1. Daniel chapter 1, verses 1 to 8. And it says, in the third year of the reign of Jehoiakim, have we opened our Bible to Daniel? Some people are still looking for it in the New Testament. Tell your neighbor, Daniel is not in the New Testament. It is in the Old Testament. In the third year of the reign of Jehoiakim, king of Judah, came Nebuchadnezzar, king of Babylon, unto Jerusalem, and he besieged it. The Lord gave Jehoiakim, king of Judah, into his hand with part of the vessel of the house of God, which he carried into the land of Shina, to the house of his God, and he brought the vessel into the treasure house of his God. The king spake unto Abner, the master of his eunuch, that he should bring certain of the children of Israel, and of the king's seed, and of the princes, children in whom was no blemish, but well favored, and skillful in all wisdom, cunning in knowledge and understanding science, and such as had ability in them to stand in the king's palace, and those whom they might teach the learning and the tongue of the Chaldeans. The king appointed them a daily portion of the king's meat and of the wine which he drank, so nourishing them 3 years, that at the end thereof they might stand before the king. Now among these were the children of Judah, Daniel, Ananiah, Mishael, and Azariah, these are the original ones, unto whom the prince of the eunuch remained. For he gave unto Daniel the name of Belshazzar, and to Ananiah Shadrach, and to Mishael of Mel, he called him Meshach, and Azariah he called what? Abednego. But Daniel proposed in his heart that he would not defile himself with the portion of the king's meat, nor with the wine which he drank thereof. He requested of the prince of the eunuch that he might not defile himself. Now, what is this telling us? You find that there was a king that went and waged war and took over another city. And because King Nebuchadnezzar of Babylon was very strong, he besieged Israel. And this incident left Israel defeated. They lived a life of slavery and servitude. You know, they lived a life of constant harassment by this king. In fact, many of them became intimidated, and the spirit of oppression has done so much that they could not even do anything. Is that not the same thing that is going on in my life and in your life? That we find that the devil has so much, done so much to besiege our life in such a way that we are not able to act the way God expects us to. But my prayer for you today is that God will set you free in the name of Jesus. Yeah. See, the spirit of oppression has done a lot havoc to the children of God, even in this present time. Some are bogged down with sickness, some are bogged down with diseases, some are bogged down with lack, some the problem is mental, some the problem is marital, some is even joblessness, some it is spiritual oppression from the devil. But I'm here to tell you that whatever the devil is doing to make life unbearable for you, God will do what? He will show you the way out in Jesus' name.
Amen.
I say he will show you the way out in Jesus' name.
Amen.
There is hope for you.
Amen.
There is restoration for you.
Amen.
Because they that know their God shall be what? Shall be strong, and they shall do what? Exploit. And by the mandate of heaven, I want to pray for you. I decree that there will be an open disgrace to all your oppressors in the name of Jesus. I pray for you that the finger of God will unseat every oppressor in your life in the name of Jesus. I pray that the fire of God will consume any oppressor trying to slow you down or just fix you on constant on one spot in the name of Jesus.
Yeah.
Every prophetic word that has been spoken, either by our Father in the Lord or by other ministers of God, will find fulfillment in your life in Jesus' name.
Yeah.
Three things before we go to pray that I want to bring out from that portion that we read is that those who know God, they have great energy for God. I said, those who do what? Who know God, they have what?
Great
energy. The question I ask you is that the energy you have, when do you expend it? Turn to your neighbor. Say, the energy God has given to you, when do you normally expend it? You see, Daniel and his three friends were men who knew God. And And they decided to expend their energy on what is of God. They were men compelled from time to time to actively stand out against situations that are anti-God operating in the environment. This king got hold of them and brought them into his palace and said, give them food that had been offered to idols. And they said, look, we would rather eat vegetable or salad. Maybe let's look at it from that. Some of us don't like eating salad, but they will tell you, eat healthy and eat salad. Not the Imbombo, all the fruit salad, and all the... I know you understand that. But what we're saying is that they choose not to eat what? The food that has been offered to what? Idols. They said, rather than eat that, we will eat salad. And the man who was on the authority said, you will kill me because the king will chop off my head. Because by the time you come, you are looking sick and then. And he said, you try us out. We'll eat salad, water, and that will be good. And they ate salad. And what happened? Their countenance was much more better than the people eating the heavy food, isn't it? What are we saying, brethren? Dairos suspended, if you look at the Bible, the practice of prayer. That is good. That's another portion in Daniel chapter 6, verse 10. He said nobody should pray. Where? In the kingdom. But what happened? Daniel went on praying. How many times? 3 days. Daily, with his window open so that everyone might see. Now the question I'm asking us today is that in America that we find ourselves, because what we're looking at, that is the first point, that those people who know their God shall do what? They shall have great energy. For who? For God. Meaning that those who know their God are sensitive to situations in which God's truth and honor are being directly or tacitly jeopardized. Me and you were in America today, isn't it? Now, America has redefined what the marriage law or marriage between man and woman is. They said, no, it is no longer marriage between man and woman. It can be marriage between what? Man and man. And marriage between who again? Do we find that in the law of God? But the question I'm asking is that what have you done about it? What have I done about it? Today in America, the Bible has been taken away. When my children were still in the, when we go for any of their program, you, when they started, you don't know. When they are finished, you don't know. Because no prayer was said at the beginning, no prayer was said at the end. Everybody would just stand up and you find that they disappear. America says no prayer, not even the word of God, in public places. And when you are going, they say no soliciting. But when gay and transgender comes, we give them the full attention. They will be the people on our first page. Don't you think something is wrong somewhere? Now the issue is that, what are you doing? What am I doing? Where in this land? Brethren, you can see that we need to cry to God. Because we must look at what it was that these people did. They said, don't pray. But they still went ahead and did what? Pray. They said, don't witness. If you look at Acts of Apostles chapter 2, and those people say, who are we to fear? Is it you or God? Today, many of us do not like to witness because they said, no soliciting. And so, well, God, you understand, I'm in a place where they said, no what? God is going to bring to you on the last day people that are in Iraq, people that are in USSR, China, people where they don't even allow the Bible, and you find heavily how they are witnessing, then you will look back and see that, truly, the people who know their God, they shall do what? They shall be strong, and they shall do what? Exploit. God is counting on you. Turn to your neighbor. God is counting on you for this land. If you will seek Him, He will grant you the power to do the impossible in this nation. And my prayer is that God will help us in Jesus' name.
Amen.
But that is not just it. Even in your own private life, Do you know that there is no challenge or oppression that is greater than the power of God? Is that not what Jeremiah 32 verse 27 says? Jeremiah 32, 27, what does it say? We don't know it. Okay, let me read it. 32, 27 says, behold, I am the God of all flesh. Is there anything too hard for me? No matter what is passing through or what you are passing through, no matter the situation, we have a God that can turn hopeless situations around. God is always a step ahead of your challenges. If you but will do what? Seek Him. Because He said, if you seek Him, you will do what? You will find Him. Also, it does not matter how many times you have failed. It does not matter how many times the enemy has oppressed you. In God, you will always find healing. In God, you will always find restoration. In God, you will always find fulfillment. In God, you will always find solution. But brethren, we can only do that if we will do what? Seek Him. If I choose to seek Him, you find that things we call problem, they will no longer be problem. Maybe you don't understand. I have always seen challenges that faces me. Every challenge and problem I face is an opportunity. And it is a reason for the Jesus that is inside of me to manifest. But when I do not see it from that point of view, I will always think that, oh, this God is not good. He only wants to just make me feel bogged down by the problem. No. It is a reason. I was sharing with the pastor yesterday. When we bought our new place, it was so much a problem. North America will not give you a name. When you write to these people, they will say, when do we have our own problem? So the only place to go now is to go where? Is to seek God and say, God, what is the solution to this problem? Which many of us don't like to do. We'll rather go to uncle, to aunt, to friend and say, look, do what? I'm in this problem. But God is saying, first of all, do what? Come to me, because I have the last say. And I went to God, and God gave me a strategy. And may I let you know, that strategy brought out $100,000 FOC. I did not have to pay a dime. And then we constructed and we built the place. What am I saying is that they that know their God shall be what?
Strong.
They shall be strong and they will do what? God is depending on you to go exploit. Not only in your own life, in your family, but where? In your neighborhood. And I'm sure you will not disappoint him. Will you disappoint him?
No.
3 points I said. The first thing is that, what did I say? The first point is that those that know God will do what?
Energy.
They will exhibit the energy of who? God. The second thing that I want to say is that those who know God have great thoughts. They have what? Great thoughts of God. Each time they think, they don't think of any other thing, but they think about who? God. How many times do you just sit down and say, look, in my thoughts, you are just looking and say, oh God, how beautiful. You didn't come to church. Because some of us, when we come to church, we say, how great now! But after that, you have blocked that portion. You say, oh, let's face reality. And then you go. There are times I will just come outside, I will look and say, oh, this God is great. Look at the skies. Look at the environment. Look at what God has created. Is that not what God expects us to do? Many of us, the thought of God are not in our heart. It's only in our heart when we are aware in the church. Even in the church, it is not even there. Because as I'm talking, as I'm looking at you now, some thoughts, some hearts have traveled far. Maybe it's in Washington State now, or maybe it's somewhere. And yet you are looking at me. I'm not fooled. But what I'm telling you is that those who know God have what? They have great thoughts of God. the central truth with Daniel and his three friends is that they have what they thought of God. If you look at Daniel chapter 2 and 4, of which we're reminded of Belshazzar in chapters 5, 18 to 23, is that the most high rulers in where? In the kingdom of men. Open your Bible to Daniel chapter 4 briefly. Daniel chapter 4, that is the thought in the life of this man and his three friends. Are we there? Daniel chapter 4, 25. I read it. It says that they shall drive thee from men, and thy dwelling shall be with the beast of the field, and they shall make thee to eat grass as oxen, and they shall wet thee with the dews of heaven, and 7 times shall pass over thee till thou know that the most what? High ruleth in the kingdom of men, and he giveth it to whomsoever he wills. This is the thought in the life of Daniel. Their thought is that the most high does what? Reigns in the affairs of men. Anytime you have that same thought, I'm telling you, there is no challenge, no problem that can face you. Because you believe that God has what? The final say. When you have this thought all the time, you find that you will see that there is nothing that happens to you that has not first passed through God, that God has not seen it. No matter the challenge, because the thought that is going on in your heart is that God is able. God is more than sufficient. Say, I have a God. Apostle Paul said, for I know whom I have what? I have believed, and I'm persuaded that he's able to do what? To keep that which has been committed unto him. That is the thought in your heart. But if your thought is always the, I'm in another trouble, I don't even know what to do. Then you are not thinking right about what God can do in your life. But God is saying that those who know God, they have great thoughts about who? About God. Because of time, look at what happened in, what will I call it now? Daniel. Okay, let's read Romans 8:18. Look at the kind of thought that goes on in the heart of people there. Romans 8:18. Romans 8:18. It says, are we there? Romans 8:18 says, for I reckon that the suffering of this present time are not worthy to be compared with what? The glory which shall be revealed. That is a thought in the life of somebody that no matter what I'm going through, I can't compare with the solution that will come. Look at verse 28 again. This is the thought of a man. And he said, we know that all things work together for good to them that do what? Love God. To them who are the called according to his purpose. This is a thought that is going on in the life of a man. Look at verse 31. Look at what the verse says. Said, what shall we then say to these things? If God be for us, who can be against us? Look at verse 35. This is the thought that is going on in the heart of a man. Who shall separate us from who? The love of Christ. Shall tribulation, or distress, or persecution, or famine, or nakedness, or peril, or sword? He said, as it is written. So you find that all these were the things that were going on. And when a man has that kind of thought, what happens? There is no problem in life that faces you that you can't do. You can't confront, because your thought is not about the problem. Your thought is about what? The solution. And not the solution, but the God behind what? The solution. For example, for somebody going through something this morning, this is the word of God for you. Second Peter, open your Bible to Second Peter. That is the word of God for you. 2 Peter chapter 5 verse 10. Second Peter 5 verse 10. Did I say Second Peter 5? First Peter 5 10. Sorry. First Peter 5 10. That is the word of God for you. What did he say? Can we read it together? Now, maybe you don't understand that. That is the kind of thought that should be going on where? In my mind. The Bible is saying that, all these things that have been happening, they have a beginning, isn't it? And because they have a beginning, they surely must have what? An end. And look at what the Bible says. He says that after that ye have what? Suffered for what? A while. Can you see the destiny of all human problems? Did you see the destiny of all human problems? He said they are only but for what? They are only but for what? A while. And except you have that in your mind, you always think that, this problem, will I ever able to get out of it? And God said, no. All the problems you may pass through, they are only but for what? A while. If you have ever visited the pharmacy, when they give you a bottle of prescription, they normally tell you what? The expiry date. Let me tell you, any problem you have always have what? It comes with what? An expiry date. And until you get focused on that, you will always think that, look, you are not going to get out of this. But God is saying, no, it is just for what?
For some time.
A while. A while. They are temporary. So the abnormal struggle that you go through will soon be over. And that's what the Bible says. Because we said, those who know God have great what? Thoughts. About who? About God. The Bible says, greater is he that is in you than what? That is the word of God. In other words, there is something in you that is able to overcome the impossibility in the world. The Bible even went ahead and tell us that if, as long as we have learned to seek the Lord, help will always come for you. And therefore, by the mandate of heaven, I'm praying for you again. I say I'm praying for you again. I declare that God of heaven will show his favor upon you in the name of Jesus. I declare by the mandate of heaven that your sickness, your barrenness expires today in the name of Jesus. You will experience a new beginning in the name of Jesus. You will break new grounds spiritually and financially and materially in the name of Jesus. God will make you a candidate for signs and wonders in the name of Jesus. The Lord will assist you beyond your human ability in the name of Jesus. Will learn to do what? Seek him. And my prayer is that you will do what? You will seek him. Now, the final thing that we need to talk about is that those who know God, they show great boldness for God. They stick out their necks. I've never seen someone who truly loves God, who does not do what? Stick out his or her neck for God. Is that not true? When God says he loved you, when God said he loved me, did he stick out his neck or not? Did he? They talk to me. Did he?
Yes.
John 3:16 said, for God loves what? So loved the world that he did what?
Yes.
He paid the prime what? Sacrifice. That he did what? He gave. So there is no way I can say I know God without being able to do what? To stick out my neck. But many of us are not ready to stick out our neck. But if you truly know God, you will want to do what? Look at what happened to Daniel and his three friends. Men who stuck their neck. If you read Daniel chapter 3, because of time we'll be able to do that. 16 and 18. Daniel 3, 16 and 18. It was the story of these people that the king came and said, aha, there is a statue that you must do what? bow down and worship. And he said, no. Men or king, we are going to do that because we are people who know God. I said, you are going to do that. And he said, you should do what? There should be an intense heat 7 times on the furnace. And the Bible said those people who took these children of God into the furnace, in fact, instantly those ones got roasted. Can you imagine you being asked to put somebody in furnace, and it is you that you took him there that did what? That got roasted. But one thing that I appreciate is that the word that these people spoke, they said, we know our God is able to do what? To save us. Say, but if peradventure he now decides he's not even going to do what? Save us. We will still not do what? Sir. Bow down to this God. These are people who have not learned to do what? Still have their name. And in cases like that, I have never seen God to fail. Because God will stand up and say, yes, these are my boys. Many of the struggles we go through is because we are not ready to do it. Stick out your leg. And until you are ready to stick out your leg, I'm telling you, God is not going to allow you to do it. Because he will stand out and say, no, this is my girl, this is my God. I'm not going to allow him or her to do what? To struggle. Brethren, those who know God, they show great what? Boldness for God. Another example you'll find in 1 Samuel 17, 51. David, the boy that was in the shepherd boy, the father called him and said, go and check your brothers. He took food. When he got there, he saw this Goliath who came to do what? To defy the name of the Lord. And he went and asked, who is this fellow? He said, oh, that is Goliath of Gath. And that he has always been a warrior from his youth. And they gave him all the statistics, all the resume of this person. In fact, the resume is enough for you to be shipped wherever you are. But because those who know their God show great boldness, what happened? He said, who is this uncircumcised book? Philistines. He said, look, I will go and do what? And face him. And before you knew what was happening, Goliath was where? On the floor. And victory came to who? So you see the reason now why that these his brothers cannot be anointed, because God sees. They were there, the name of God was being insulted. How many times in your office that people will discuss and literally they creep, you know, they will laugh him. They are insulting the name of God, say, Jesus Christ. No, Mary Magdalene was his girlfriend. And he said, and you are laughing. No, some of us are trying to the name of the Lord. It's been insulted when we have. Instead of us to do what? No, not under my watch. You don't discuss things like this. Brethren, what we're saying in essence is that those who know God should do what? Show great works, boldness. And as you do so, you find that God will come and stand by you and will fight for you in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
Brethren, time will not permit us because I'm a man under authority. I want to say the final one, that is in Numbers 13:30. Numbers 13:30 is the story of Caleb, who told the children of Israel they were asked to go and spy the land. When they got there, they saw Goliath, they saw all sorts of things. And by the time the 12 came, the kind of report they brought, you saw what? It was a report that discouraged the people. The kind of message you carry, are they messages that encourage or they are messages that discourage people? But suddenly Caleb and Joshua stood up and said, we have a God that can do what? That can bring down Goliath. And said, let's go at once and do what? And possess the land. And the other person said, no, it's not possible. Didn't you see the son of Anak? Didn't you see? We are like what? Grasshoppers. But the people who know their God, they do what? Do Bible very well. It is only Caleb and who? And Joshua, who eventually got to where? The promised land. The question I'm asking you today is this. Do you know God? If you do, are you strong? And are you doing exploit for Him? God wants you to go exploit for Him, even in this land. Don't you ever think you are ordinary, you are a spiritual being. Don't you think that you just came into this place just for the fun of it? No. God has something He wants you to accomplish. And you will accomplish it in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
There was this man of blessed memory in Bahamas. You remember his name? Doctor, who was his name?
Miles Morrow.
He said, the greatest place you see lives that never achieve their purpose is where?
Yeah.
In the graveyard. You must not depart this world except you have done exploit for the one who created you. And in the name of Jesus, I'm praying for you that you will live a life of purpose in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Shall we bow our heads to pray? Father, we want to thank you. And I want you to just appreciate the Lord. What was said this morning is that they that know their God shall be strong and they will do exploit. We said there are three things that people who know their God will do exploit will do. The first thing we said was that those that know their God have great energy for God. That's the first thing. And we said the second thing is that those that know their God have great thoughts for God. And finally, we said those that know their God, they will become bold for the Lord, and they will show great boldness for the God who has called them. I'd like to pray with you. Do you have time to seek the Lord? Many today are not seeking the Lord. Many are not finding God, but you have the opportunity to do so. Jeremiah 29:13 says, you will seek me and find me when you shall seek me with all your heart. Why don't you cry to God and say, God, help me to seek you.